Hi guys, so in this lesson we're going to take a look at a China essay which has received 38 out of 40 marks. This was written about 2011, but it's such a great example and it really provides a really clear example to follow in terms of actually adopting an appropriate structure for the China essay. So we're going to dig right on in. Right, so let's get going into this title. Discuss the extent to which the growth of the Chinese economy in recent years has been beneficial to the global economy. So within this essay, we've really got to focus on the nature of the growth that has occurred and the way in which it has actually been beneficial or not so beneficial to the global economy. Okay, those are the key themes that we'll see. Now, I really want you to pay attention to the structure of this essay. Now, look what the candidate has actually done here to organize their structure in this introductory paragraph. So we've got a short introduction. The past 30 years have seen China's growth average 9% per annum, a rate impressive by any economy. This essay aims to address four main issues. So look at this. The candidate is now separating his essay in or her essay into four clear designated themes that they will actually look at in great detail in this essay. You can see I've color-coded each of these areas and I keep the title at the top throughout this presentation just to make sure that you're reflecting back on that title. The examiner report every year really focuses on the fact that students often drift away from the essay title or they end up answering the essay question that they wish they had got. So it's really important to keep coming back to that title. You'll notice that I'll color-code the title depending upon which of the sections that we're in. Okay, so the first area in orange is, of course, cheap Chinese products for MEDCs. The next area, cheap credit for the developed world. Then we've got the influence of China on Africa and Latin American economies. Now, in the essay, the candidate really focuses on African economies rather than Latin American, but that's fine. Again, we've got a clearly identified third strand of analysis and evaluation that the candidate will be able to use. And then finally, the case for China as a role model for economic development. So those are our four key areas here. Let's get stuck into the first area then on cheap Chinese products for MEDCs. Okay, so notice the orange title that we've got. That tells us that we're still working on that theme. This is perhaps the most detailed analysis of the actual essay on this particular topic. So let's take a look. One of the most widely discussed issues about China is its ability to supply cheap products to developed countries such as the US, UK, and the EU. As China has a vast supply of labor, its wages are relatively low, and thus China has a comparative advantage in labor-intensive manufacturing. Just notice the fluency with which the candidate is able to actually bring in this concept of comparative advantage, of course, and relate it to what China had based a lot of their export orientated growth around, and that is the labor intensity that has gone into a lot of their manufacturing. Of course, in the intervening time between when this essay was written, things are, of course, changing, and you do have other countries taking up more of the slack of this labor-intensive manufacturing as wages have risen in export sectors. Okay, the direct result of these cheap goods on the West is that developed economies export their inflation to China. So the candidate is really suggesting here that it's the demand from developed MEDCs that is really fueling export growth in China and is therefore resulting in that demand going into the Chinese economy, which is of course represented by large trade surpluses corresponding with large current account surpluses. In addition, externalities are exported to China. This is another really interesting point. Consider the level of CO2 emissions the US has avoided in its own country by having China produce steel for the US. As such, over the past 30 years,
developed economies have been able to grow at high levels without correspondingly high levels of inflation and pollution. Thus, consumers enjoy a higher standard of living. Okay, so excellent analysis. You see those chains of analysis really building through this paragraph, and it's continued in the next on the same theme for cheap Chinese products to MEDCs. Nevertheless, there has been considerable debate amongst US politicians about Chinese workers stealing US jobs. This comment refers to the diversion of demand from domestically produced goods towards Chinese imports. Now, of course, this argument is very relevant with what we've seen in all sorts of protectionism-based issues regarding the US and China, and the US's concerns regarding its trade deficit with the Chinese economy. It's also interesting to note there that, of course, Yukon Huang believes that, well, the US will always run a current account deficit while it is the global reserve currency, because being the global reserve currency, people want to hold dollars, and therefore it means that the dollar is artificially inflated against what value it would have otherwise. Okay, so this critique is unfounded, as this is only to be expected by the theory of comparative advantage. So again, using that theoretical principle here, China has a comparative advantage in labor-intensive manufacturing, in which it is specialized. The US and UK in turn specializes in high technology and financial services. China demands these goods from the US and UK. A loss of jobs in the labor-intensive sector only produce jobs elsewhere, jobs that are most probably better paid. Furthermore, even if China was not to produce these goods, other emerging economies would still have a higher comparative advantage than the US. Thus, countries like Brazil, Vietnam, and India would have exactly the same effect via trade on US unemployment. That's an excellent point that's made, really not saying that it's a binary outcome, it's China or it's US made, that actually there's a whole range of producers and potential manufacturers that exist in between those two very, very different economies. Hence, China has been beneficial to developed economies by forcing US workers to retrain and have jobs higher up the value-added chain. Now, of course, since this essay was written, it's become clearer from academic research that globalization has really left very, very nasty impacts on low-skilled workers who haven't necessarily been able to actually retrain and move up and move their jobs into higher value-added sectors, as the candidate suggests there. So it's worth bearing that point in mind. Of course, with the paper one, which focused on globalization there, we saw that there was an area there in MEDCs where workers are not benefiting from increasing incomes, and there can be a generational decline in particular areas where, yeah, there's really negative externalities generated from globalization. Okay, final part on this first area then. However, China does artificially boost its comparative advantage buying up Western government bonds. The devalued yuan directly gives price competitiveness to Chinese goods. This is a distortion of the theory of comparative advantage. Again, really nice use of that concept of comparative advantage, an excellent understanding of the factors that will distort comparative advantage. Perhaps if the yuan was allowed to float, the true mechanism of free trade could come into play, dispersing US demand for cheap goods over a variety of different countries. As such, China may not be the US's biggest creditor in a floating yuan rate. Okay, so there we go. That's our first paragraph considered. We've got these this interesting point and excellent understanding evident where the student is aware of the so-called open market operations that are used to actually buy up Western government bonds. We know the Chinese government is the biggest holder of US government bonds. That's certainly a very, very good understanding of that sterilization based approach there that's used. So let's now focus on a second issue. This is the matter of cheap credit for MEDCs. So the second issue to consider is the supply of cheap credit given by the Chinese. Normally, if the US or EU wanted to raise money from government bonds, they would need to increase interest rates to attract investors. That's an excellent point, and it shows a really good understanding of how debt markets and bond markets work. However, with the demand from the Chinese government, the developed economies are able to keep interest rates low while enjoying abundant supplies of credit. This results in cheap credit cards and investment loans for US consumers and firms, effectively heightening the standard of living. Okay, so again, that's very, very nice. Of course, in recent times, we've seen that the UK savings ratio is at the lowest level it's been in many, many years, as well as household debt level being extremely high. There's a lot of concern regarding the car finance market as well, in both the US and the UK. So do we see this pattern recurring? Many people do actually think, yes, we do. Anyway, while this scenario of Chinese investors sending money to the rich world may seem ideal, cheap credit also entails imprudent investment decisions. Without the risk of high interest rates, investors are more likely to enter into contracts without first considering the likelihood of losses. Okay, so again, really good understanding of the fact that interest rates will affect the profitability of investments, and interest rates should normally reflect risk as well. Okay, so a prime example of this phenomenon is the 2008-09 subprime mortgage crisis. So subprime meaning low quality, high risk mortgages, which were sold to people who couldn't necessarily afford those mortgages in the first place. As cheap credit gives rise to a housing boom, investors eventually realize that the value of houses are not consistent with the price of associated CDOs. CDOs simply standing for collateralized debt obligations, where these low quality, high risk mortgages were packaged up into packages, which could then be resold and resold again. And whoever owned them could theoretically enjoy the actual interest payments on those mortgages for the remainder of those mortgage periods. But of course, the value of those CDOs plummeted when people started defaulting on these mortgages. Okay, don't worry about these elements. These are not as relevant now. So this is obviously sort of 10 years ago. This essay was written, as I said, 3 to 4 years after this time period. So it was far more relevant then. What's more relevant is you focus on the fact that, yes, there are still big concerns when it comes to savings ratios in MEDCs and household debt ratios, and we mentioned car finance as well. Okay, so consequently, the bubble burst resulting in a full-blown recession. This is arguably due to the global imbalance of credit created by the Chinese economy. So this imbalance still exists, of course. Okay, let's move it on to our third area now. Okay, so this one obviously reflects back onto the influence of China on African economies in particular here. So let's take a look. The other main group of economies affected is the developing world. As China grows in size, it will gain increasing influence of world trade talks. As a result, China has been gathering groups of poor economies, including itself, to challenge the Washington consensus. Up until now, the US and the EU dominated talks on tariffs and trade barriers, both agreeing to subsidize heavily their domestic market for textiles and agriculture. Policies such as the Common Agricultural Policy directly undermine the theory of comparative advantage. Okay, so this Common Agricultural Policy is obviously about the subsidies and payments that go to agricultural producers within the EU. Now, that undermines the theory of comparative advantage. If African countries and China are able to access these markets through the removal of subsidies in the US and EU, Africa is likely to experience tremendous amounts of growth. In addition, the EU and US themselves are likely to benefit from lower priced agricultural and textile products. Okay, so yeah, really, really interesting paragraph considered there. So I love this first point, that as China grows in size, it will gain increasing influence. That is continuing to happen, of course. And as a result, China has been gathering groups of poor economies, including itself, to challenge the Washington consensus. So that is still very, very apparent. Okay, so nice paragraph there. Moreover, China has been providing Africa with demand of its own. As China has never been able to feed itself, it demands vast amounts of imports for food, metal, and energy. As the demand for the good increases, the price and quantity produced should increase, thus increasing export earnings for Africa, so it is able to invest this money into infrastructure and healthcare. On the other hand, China has been setting up extraction plants of its own all over Africa. Since more often than not, Africa is unable to build factories of its own, Chinese firms will benefit by extracting raw commodities and leaking profits back to China. Hence, the mutually advantageous agreement may be only hopeful if China takes advantage of African resources. Furthermore, China's demand for food will push prices of commodities up in general. Thus, even as Africa earns more, it will also have to pay more for food and energy. Okay, so some really strong analysis there, and this is our final paragraph on this issue, which really looks at many evaluative points as well. So important, with 18 marks of evaluation available, that you do make judgments through your essay. So let's take a look. In addition, China's demand for natural resources will encourage African countries such as Sudan and Zambia to continue growing, to continue producing these goods without moving into more profitable industries like manufacturing. That's a very nice point. Now, it's certainly hoped from the Bridge and Road Initiative that China is going to help many African economies, as well as many other economies that benefit from the road project, that China can aid their economic development and encourage them to move into manufacturing and industrialize further. Whether they do so or not is certainly open to debate. As such, Africa may become addicted to export-led growth, fueled by abusing its natural resources. Moreover, as prices for basic commodities rise at a slower rate than the prices of high-tech and capital-intensive goods, Africa will endure deteriorating terms of trade. So here the candidate is using the Priebisch-Singer hypothesis to really look at the detailed impact that is likely to happen over the longer term period if Africa continues to rely upon its primary produce. Okay, so this means that Africa will have to export increasing quantities of commodities in order to buy the same quantity of imports. Another factor to consider is that China itself is providing Africa with cheap labor-intensive manufacturing. This is critical to Africa's development as it is not able to produce these goods itself. However, it could be said that even if the prices are low, most Africans are more worried about surviving by buying food and medicine. Since their income is so low, their priorities will not be in products that China produces. Okay, so that's a very, very interesting, very detailed part of this essay that the candidate has considered here. There's some excellent longer term judgments that are made here, as well as the fact that Africa, in the candidate's eyes, as things are right now, and therefore how they're likely to be in the longer term, is likely to continue. So now let's see what the candidate thinks of China as a role model for economic development. So the last factor to consider is China's case as a role model for development. Many economists heralded China's growth as a demonstration of the benefits of the free market, as it introduces profit incentives and open door policies, so more open market policies. Okay, the economy grows and its population benefits. Nevertheless, one has to consider other issues that may have aided China. For example, by 1978, when Deng Xiaoping introduced free market reforms, China was already industrialized by Mao's Great Leap Forward. So real bit of economic history coming into this essay now. By directing resources towards building factories, the population starved and the production possibility curve expanded to PPC2. So the candidate just used a very simple PPC diagram with an expanding PPC. Moreover, China's large population is a feature that cannot be replicated anywhere else in the world. The only country, of course, that can bear any similarity in terms of population is, of course, India. But perhaps more importantly, one must question the extent to which China is a free market. The devalued yuan and government-owned banks are hardly characteristics of the free market. Okay, so a short paragraph there, but very, very nice analysis, together with judgments here at the end of that. So now let's look at how the candidate has finished this essay off in real style by making sure they've used an excellent judgment at the end of this essay. So to conclude, having addressed the supply of cheap Chinese products and credit and the developing world, the benefited parties can be divided into two main groups, the developed world and the less developed world. Cheap Chinese products have undoubtedly elevated the developed world standard of living, allowing for high levels of growth with low inflation and pollution that should include that. The influence of China in the US unemployment rate can be dismissed due to comparisons of specialization and moving up jobs to higher value and valued industries. Cheap credit may have inflated the subprime mortgage crisis and caused the global recession in 2008-9, while it's tempting to conclude that African economies benefit from higher export earnings, Chinese extraction plants, leakages, profit, and deteriorating terms of trade must also be taken into account. Moreover, the cheap supply of Chinese goods probably had marginal effects on Africa's consumers, considering the composition of the African consumerism pattern. So finally, the case of China as a role model may be overstated, as the conditions of its growth are unique to its country, to its economy and its distinct factor endowments. That is simply the factors of production that are unique to the country. So this judgment doesn't simply restate points that have been said previously in the essay. It goes beyond that and really brings together all four strands of analysis that the candidate has used through this essay. So it's a really strong judgment. Overall, this essay scored 18 out of 18 for evaluation because the way that evaluation and judgments were made throughout the essay. Meanwhile, it scored 20 out of 22 for analysis. So very, very strong essay indeed.